Pale Hands That Kill.
Welcome, dear Helen. Welcome to the new shop of Marita Dressmaker.
Oh, thank you, Marie. My, but it's a charming shop.
Yes, Helen. It is a place where you will be able to learn much as my assistant.
Oh, I know that, Marie. Where's your husband, Paul?
Oh, I expect he will be calling for me shortly. You will be able to meet him.
Is there anything wrong? You sounded so sad just then.
I'm sorry, my dear. I was just thinking of the sad memories this lovely little shop contains. You see, there's a story to this shop, Helen. A strange and tragic story. Tell me, have you ever heard of Kathy Sloan?
Did you see her this shop before you?
Yes, my dear. This was the place where Kathy Sloan, the dressmaker, daily performed miracles with needle and cloth.
Tell me about her, Mary.
Kathy was not a beautiful woman. She had charm. A vitality which did not permit rest. And a talent. A talent that rested in her hands. They were long, pale hands. Lovely hands. They fascinated me each time I saw them. Kathy was married to Stephen Sloan, a painter. One evening, as Stephen entered the shop, he found another woman here, talking to Kathy.
Well, hello. Who's the breathing mannequin, darling?
Oh, hello, Steve. This is Alice Barton, my new assistant.
Wow. Welcome, Alice.
Thank you, Mr. Sloan. I know I'll be happy here.
I'm going to make that my own personal responsibility.
It's rather late, Steve. So we go.
Can we drop you off anywhere, Alice?
I don't think so, Mr. Sloan. I still have some work to do. Thanks, Mr. Sloan.
Okay, then. Be seeing you. I think that can't be a hurt.
Oh, really, Steve? You embarrassed the poor girl.
Oh, it's the other way around. She embarrassed me. That girl is pretty.
Trying to get me jealous, darling?
Of course not. Driver, 12 o'clock back.
Now, Steve, I don't think I could stand the repetition of your last romance.
Don't be childish, Kathy.
She wasn't very pretty, either.
Let's drop the subject.
All right, darling. It's just as unpleasant to me.
Well, it wasn't to me. You had the whole thing wrong from the start.
Oh, don't be angry, Steve. I've forgotten all about it.
Sometimes I wish I hadn't.
Steve!
No, forget it. I'm sorry.
What do you mean by that?
I don't know. It's not clear in my mind.
That isn't clear.
Let me alone, will you? Let me alone. Hello. Mind if I walk with you?
Steve, you're getting a start for a moment.
Now, Alice, do I look like the kind of a guy who'd pick up a girl on the street?
As a matter of fact, you do.
Oh, I've been waiting for you to come out of that shop for over an hour, Alice.
I'm sorry, Steve, but Kathy has an extra work for me to do, and I thought I'd get a chance. I didn't realize you were waiting.
You knew I'd be here, honey, didn't you?
Yes, Steve, I knew.
Does Kathy suspect I've been seeing you, and does she know I love
her? I don't know, Steve. She puzzles me. Sometimes I catch her watching me. She looks so strange, and it frightens me.
Don't let her down. What can she possibly do if she does find out?
Except that I don't know. It seems to hurt. I'm frightened of it.
Oh, you're imagining things.
This morning, she was trying out a kiss on a mannequin. Her hands began sparking on a necklace, and I watched her fingers closely. It fascinated me. She curled her fingers around her neck and began tightening her grip, and it was as if she was trying to strangle the mannequin.
Alice, that's nonsense. Can't be that crazy. Who ever heard of choking a dummy?
But Steve, I was there. I saw it too.
Look, Alice, forget it. Just a little while longer, and we'll both be out of this mess. I'm in no mood for a triangle.
Neither am I, Steve. You have to make up your mind soon. It's either Kathy or me. I kept your dinner warm, Steve.
Don't bother. I'm not hungry.
Where's your dinner?
It's out.
By yourself?
No.
Well, where did you go?
I stopped in at a nightlight on Third Street.
Why did you phone me?
I might have wanted to go.
Well, I forgot.
Look, darling, let's drop the pretense. I know where you've been.
But, Daddy, it's a little late for that witness stand routine. I'm going to bed.
Not until we understand each other, Steve. I don't intend to sit idle by and be made a fool of.
Look, Kathy, melodrama at night is too unnerving for me. But what's wrong with you? You wear those lovely hands of yours to the bone if you keep twisting them like that.
I know you've been seeing Alice. I won't stand for Steve. I won't.
What do you think you can do about it?
You've got to choose between us.
Will you leave me alone? This thing is coming around in my mind like a top. I'll decide. And gone soon. Hello. Let me be, folks. You know what that cultured gentleman at the end of the bar is thinking, right? You are coming right up.
Yes. How was he this morning?
She doesn't calm down like she usually does. I've got to admit, I'm a little bit worried about her, Alice.
I can't forget how she behaved with that mannequin yesterday.
Well, that doesn't bother me, Alice. I know she wouldn't do anything drastic.
Then, what's wrong?
This morning, at breakfast, she didn't say a word. She just sat there.
Steve.
No.
Look out the window. That girl getting into a cab. It looks like Kathy.
Oh, that's not Kathy. It must be called her. In fact, she didn't have a red coat like that girl was wearing.
Oh. Here they are, folks.
Oh, thank you, well.
This can't go on. I'm frightened.
It isn't
good for any of it.
Look, Alice. We need some fresh air, hmm? Let's get out of here and take a walk in the park. Maybe the fresh air will clear our heads so we can think.
This is about as far as we could go, sir.
Why, what do you mean?
I can walk on easily from here. Just a short walk across the park.
Alice, I don't want to take you home.
I'd rather not. Steve, listen to me. We can't go on like this any longer. He won't tell me that it's so, but we know it. We know there has to be a stop. I tell you what, Peter, it doesn't even matter. I'm meeting secretly in that tiny coffin, hiding it somewhere like an ugly sin.
What do you want me to do?
I told you. You've got to decide, Steve. You've got to make up your mind which one of us you want.
It's a tough decision, Alice. My home and Kathy against an unknown future and you.
I'm going. If you're here tomorrow night at the same time, I know you want me. It's not safe. Goodbye.
Alice, wait. Which one? Where's the bartender?
I don't know. He served me a drink and then went somewhere in the back. Hey, what's the matter? You got trouble?
Oh, plenty.
A woman, huh?
No, two of them.
Oh, yeah, you really got trouble. Hey, look, take my glass. You need it more than I do.
Oh, thanks. You better finish it.
Look, what do they pay that guy for except the 10 bar?
I don't know. Oh, no, no, sir.
Picture
that? Oh, I can't wait all night. So long.
Okay, they're always taking them pictures. Always flashing those things off. Uh-oh, be careful, eh? Hey, you pull your jacket on that hook.
Yeah, I know.
There's a good tailor right down the street. So long.
Is that you, Kathy?
Yes, sir. I didn't mean to wake you.
That's all right. It's still been pretty late.
I expected you to be waiting up for me as usual, but I'm glad you're here now.
Kathy, I've got to talk to you. It's important.
Not now. It's very late.
No, it's important. I can't wait.
Maybe you have to. Whatever it is the morning we do. But, see, you've torn your jacket.
Yeah, I caught it on a hook in a bar downtown just a little while ago.
And I'll relieve it for you in the morning just before I go to the shop. No one tells the difference. I'll make the cloth look practically brand new. All right, I'm coming. I'm now hoping that'd be so early in the morning.
Mrs. Sloan?
Yes?
I'm Inspector Conrad, Homicide Bureau.
Homicide Bureau?
Yeah. Sorry to disturb you this early, but it's important.
Oh, of course. Come in, Inspector.
Thank you, Miss Sloan. Is your husband at home?
Yes.
Who's this fellow?
Inspector Conrad of the Homicide Bureau.
Huh? Well, what did you want with us?
I was just coming to that, Mr. Sloan. We'd like to ask you a few questions about the murder of Alice Barton.
Oh, you can't mean it.
I'm afraid that I do.
But when did it happen?
Last night. She was killed in Brentwood Park.
What do you want of my husband?
He was known to have been with Miss Barton last night.
What? That can't be true.
We have this one testimony of a bartender at a cafe where he and Miss Barton stopped to prove it. We also heard him invite Miss Barton for a walk in the park.
Steve, is all this true?
I'm afraid it is. Well, I didn't kill her. I left her a few blocks from her house, in front of the park. She crossed the street and went into the park when I left her.
Where did you go after that?
I went back to the bar where we'd been earlier.
The bartender didn't mention that to us.
Well, he wasn't there. He was in the back of the cafe someplace. I don't know.
Then how can you prove you were there?
Wait a minute. I have got something. I tore my jacket on the way out, and I hit by the door.
Yeah, let's see your jacket.
Sure. Here it is.
Hmm. You must have been very drunk last night during all this, Sloan.
What do you mean?
There's no tear in this jacket. Why, the cloth is practically brand new.
The little dress shop on a side street has a strange story. Marie, the proprietor, stands before her new assistant, telling the story of Kathy Sloan, a dressmaker who owned the shop before her.
It is now easy to understand, my dear Helen, the tragedy of Kathy Sloan, who once owned the shop. Well, what happened after Inspector Conrad accused her husband Steve of murder? Well, the evidence was against him. As you know, he claimed that after he had left Alice outside the park on her way home, he had returned to the small bar where he had been with her earlier.
But he couldn't prove he was there.
And that is right. The bartender had not been behind the bar when Sloan claimed he had returned. But he swore that he could still prove he was at the bar by the tear in his jacket made by a hook on the door.
His wife, Kathy, must have rewoven the jacket during the night.
That's right. Rising early, she had fixed her husband's coat and thus removed his only chance of proving his innocence.
Oh, poor Kathy.
How horrible all of this must have been for her. Well, the story goes on, Helen. We shall see. We shall see.
Oh, what a terrible place this prison is. My poor darling.
What do you want, Kathy?
Oh, Steve, darling, please. I was only trying to help you. I didn't realize the tear in your jacket was your alibi.
Why did you hesitate just then?
Oh, Steve, why did you do it?
Do you think I'm guilty?
Keep out of here, will you?
You're in pain. I didn't kill Alice. Oh, stop wringing those hands of yours. I'm not dead yet.
Those hands? What is it, Steve? I don't understand you.
She told me, but I only laughed. She watched you with that mannequin. How you put those long, ugly fingers of yours around its neck. How your fingers dug in tighter and tighter.
You don't know what to say.
She told me, you.
Darling, please, you're wrong. I love you. Please.
You've got to tell them, Jackie. You've got to confess.
Confess? I don't know what you're talking about.
They won't kill me, Kathy. They'll find you out. You'll die for murdering Alice. Alice, the girl I love. You hear that? Alice.
Please, don't.
I love Alice. I love her.
It's no use, Mrs. Sloan. I've heard this scene 100 times in my office here.
But Inspector Conrad, I tell you, he's innocent.
That's just what I mean, Mrs. Sloan. Of course you say he's innocent. Any wife in your place would say that.
You're basing your evidence on the torn jacket.
There was no torn jacket. The cloth was perfect.
And I tell you that I rewove it. My husband showed me the tear, and I fixed it before he awoke.
I understand that you have a reputation as an expert dressmaker, Mrs. Sloan, but I still don't believe that you rewove your husband's jacket.
Oh, my husband isn't capable of murder.
I believe there isn't a person alive who isn't capable of murder. I'm sorry, but I'll have to end our interview.
He loved her. He told me that. But I know he didn't do it.
He admitted to you that he was in love with her?
Well, yes, but that doesn't really prove anything.
Quite to the contrary, Mrs. Sloan. It only strengthens my belief that your husband is guilty.
Hello?
Hello. Is this Mrs. Sloan?
Yes. Who's this?
My name is Jimmy Barnes. I'm the bartender.
I'm afraid I don't recall.
Sure, you do. Inspector Conrad asked me to identify your husband as coming back at such a time, but I couldn't remember.
Oh, well, yes, Mr. Bond. I haven't forgotten you.
Well, I just be sorry for not saying I seen him come back, but that's the truth, Mr. Bond. I had no choice.
Why have you called me, Mr. Bond?
Well, I could do it for you.
What do you mean?
Well, just this is it. Like a minute. Some fellow just came in here a few minutes ago and showed me a flashball picture of himself and his girlfriend that was taken at the bar the exact same time your husband claimed he was in here.
I still don't understand.
I'll have it to you in a minute. In the corner of the picture, there's a man seen just walking away from the bar. That man, Mrs. Claude, is your husband.
Are you sure?
That's positive. As a matter of fact, the whole thing is so clear it even shows your husband's jacket being held by some sort of hook by the door, but it's not important.
Have you called Inspector Conrad yet?
No, I thought I'd let you know first.
Don't phone him then. I want to tell him myself.
Well, it's safe.
Don't do a thing till I get there. I'll be right over.
But, Mrs. Thorne, why do you want the picture?
I just told you. I have an appointment with Inspector Conrad this evening, and I want to give it to him.
Oh. Well, I guess it's all right.
Oh, please, Mr. Barnes, the sooner I give the photograph to the inspector, the sooner my husband will be released and cleared of suspicion. Please let me have it.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Here we are. Believe me, Mrs. Sloan, I know you've gone through a lot, but the troubles are all over now.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Barnes.
You're entirely welcome. Good night, Mrs. Sloan. Good luck to you.
You don't mind my calling on you like this, but I need a little more information.
Oh, not at all. I'll be glad to help.
And while we're talking, I wonder if you wouldn't mind repairing this slight rip in my sleeve.
Of course not. Let me have it.
Thank you. You know, Mrs. Sloan, I've been thinking quite a lot about what you told me today.
What in particular, Inspector Conrad?
About your husband being in love with Miss Barton. Tell me, why do you continue to stick by him, knowing that?
Oh, it's simple, Inspector. I still love him.
I don't mind saying that this case against your husband isn't as airtight as I thought. A couple of disturbing factors have come up.
You mean you discovered new evidence?
No, it's not quite that. You see, I thought all along that your insistence on your husband's innocence was just the same old story. But frankly, you've kept me wondering.
Oh, well, here's your coat, Inspector Conrad.
Yeah, thanks. Hey, this is an excellent job. You really are a wizard with a needle. I can't tell that the cloth was ever torn.
Yeah, I told you that I did the same thing with my husband's jacket, but you wouldn't listen.
I'm sorry. There's been a mistake. I'm going to release your husband from custody.
Then you have the real murderer?
Not yet.
But you've got to get him. No one in the city is safe until you arrest him. It's safe as if he strangled poor Alice and broke her neck so that he's a maniac. You've got to get him.
We will, Mrs. Sloan. But with your husband coming home now, you'll have good protection. You'll be all right now. You haven't a thing in the world to worry about.
I'm back, Kathy.
Oh, darling. Oh, it's wonderful having you back.
Cut it out, Kathy.
Steve, what's wrong?
Don't touch me.
After the way I fought the enemy.
That's the only thing I can't figure out. But it's probably part of your scheme to pin the murder on somebody else.
Oh, stop talking like that.
But your little plan won't work. You haven't got a chance.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Why do you think they let me go? They know who the real killer is. You can't live with a murderer, Kathy. They'll discover you. They'll find you out. You can't escape.
Inspector Conrad.
Oh, Inspector, you can talk slow. You've got to help me.
What's wrong?
My husband, he's gone crazy. Last night he slept,
it was almost
soothing the way he talked. When did he say? He passed as he described killing with Alice Barton. And when he awoke later, I saw him having told me it was horrible.
Did he hurt you?
No. I got up as he came near me, and when he quickly made believe he was just looking for something. Oh, please, Inspector, you've got to help me. I haven't
been
here. I know it now. He's a murderer.
Sloan, you're safe here. No one can hurt you.
Oh, thank you, Inspector. The whole thing's been such a nightmare. I always believed in innocence. And then to find that he really did to me. It's just too much to stand.
I know how you feel. Excuse me a minute, Mrs. Sloan, but there's someone outside waiting to see you.
Me? Who is it?
I'll ask him to come in. Come in, Mr. Barnes.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Oh. Hello, Mrs. Sloan.
You two have met, I know.
Yes, Inspector.
Do you like pictures, Mrs. Sloan? Mr. Barnes has a very interesting group photograph.
But it can't. I have it.
I'm afraid that's only partially true, Mrs. Sloan. You see, there are several prints of this in circulation. Why didn't you show me the one that Mr. Barnes gave you?
Well, I lost it. Let me alone.
During this case, your husband tried to prove that he was in a bar at the approximate time Alice Barton was killed. You rewove the tear in his jacket, and thus disproved his alibi. But this photograph proves your husband's story. Still, you withheld it from me.
I meant to send it to you, but it slipped my mind.
Possibly, Mrs. Sloan, but there's one fact that you overlooked.
You're making a mistake, Inspector Conrad.
The last time I saw you, the night you proved your talent with a needle and thread, you told me something that made me release your husband. It proved him innocent and established the guilt of someone else.
I didn't say anything like that.
Oh, but you did, Mrs. Sloan. You forgot one fact, and that fact gave the killer's identity away.
What did I say?
You told me how Alice Barton had been killed, strangled, and her neck broken. That fact had never been publicized. It was known only to the police and one other person, the murderer. How did you know the fact, Mrs. Sloan?
Do you see, my dear Helen? This fact is quite a story, please, ma'am.
They executed her, didn't they, Mary?
Yes, Helen. Kathy was judged guilty, and a few weeks after her trial, she was put to death.
Good evening, Mary, my dear. And who is this charming
young man? Helen, this is my husband, Paul.
Your husband?
How do you do? Well, I must be going.
Well, can we drive you somewhere?
Oh, no. Oh, thank you. Goodbye. Thank you for telling me the story, Mary.
Huh? Mary? Well, what did you do to frighten that girl so?
Oh, nothing, sir. I just told her a simple story. That's all. Just a story.